Hello everyone, this is George from Digital Art Scope, and today we'll be working on enhancing the look of this iPhone 5C case. So as you can see, I'm inside 123D design. This is a relatively new software from Autodesk, so if you're not familiar with it, it's very user friendly, and I really encourage you to go to just Google this and you'll find the website. It's one of the software suites that 123D represents. So this is the design version. There are other software that help you fabricate, sculpt, or enhance the 3D printing experience. So by all means, go and check these out. They're all free to use for non-commercial use. Now, I've made this base case already in 123D design, so this won't be about building this up, but I just want to get you familiar with the software and also see how we can make something interesting out of this. And keep in mind that you can download this base mesh from the site. Now, first of all, I will just hide this out, maybe also the sketch. Okay, so this is the interface of the software, and we notice we have this grid on the bottom. This actually stands for the print pad of a standard 3D printer. So it has 25 centimeters on each side. You'll see I'm working in millimeters, which is what I would recommend anyone to do, since shapeways or other open 3D printing markets use this standard more often. Now, about navigation, it is fairly straightforward. Mostly using just two buttons of the mouse. The right button, when clicked and dragged, orbits the view, whereas the middle mouse button pans the view. You can also use the left button, which normally is used for making selections, to hover over the cube and just click and drag. And this will also pivot the view around a pivot point. So pretty much what the right mouse button does. Now you can also switch the views using the cube, and also if you right click on it, you can go to orthographic view mode. But we'll talk about this in just a second. Now let's make a simple object. You've noticed how all the creation and editing tools are all stacked here above, whereas the navigation and other view controls are here on the right side. Now I've went to the primitives tab and chosen a box, so it's really straightforward. I can delete this and remake it. You can notice how I can choose right from the start the dimensions for my box. However, if I just lay it anywhere on the grid, I can edit it further by clicking once on it to select the object, and then I can click once more and select the sub-objects that interest me. So what are these sub-objects? Well, if this is the object and I can, for instance, move it, right, or on several axes, I can also control the precise distance. Now, the sub-objects are the elements that make up this model. In our case, we have faces, edges, and vertices. Now, I'll press Escape to cancel the movement command. Now, once I have this selected, so I can deselect it to show you, See, now I cannot access any sub-object, so I need to click once. And then when I click twice, you notice how the sub-objects get highlighted. So I can select this face, for instance, and also always this pop-up toggle will show up. In 1-2-3D design, these pop-up toggles always tend to just pop into view. Many of the available controls have this behavior. And now if you hover over this tooltip, you see all the options that you can use. In our case, I can use press and pull and simply move this, extrude this further. So it's really, really simple, really straightforward work. Now you press enter to confirm. I can tweak this, for instance, if I want to get a more deformed shape. And also I can shell the model. So this is probably one of the most complex operations you could do. So it's the third here, shell. This will in fact make a gap in the model, and what you see here, this distance here, is also the distance of the back, the thickness of the back plate, we could say. Okay, so you can also type this and make it larger, so 5 millimeters. When working for 3D print, you have to be very, very conscious about the dimensions that you're using. You can't go below a certain level because it won't print properly, or it will snap in time. Okay, so this is one creation method using primitives. The delete key just erases the model. But we can also access some more powerful creation methods using sketches. So we can pretty much draw anything, and it will make these sketches. And once you finish the sketch, you can click that or press enter. Now the sketch is a very powerful component, because once made, you can reshape it however you like. And then again, if you select it, you have access to all of these creation methods or multiplication methods, the simplest of which is obviously extrude. So you just extrude an object. Okay, so I won't go in depth into all of these, maybe in a different tutorial, but just go ahead and play with them. Okay, so I'll just press enter here. Now, an interesting fact about 1-2-3D design is that it treats sketches and geometry differently. I haven't lost my sketch when I've extruded it. It remains untouched. Okay. And also, when I sketch, I don't think you noticed, but since I can make a circle, it will ask me, you notice this tooltip around my mouse. It says, select sketch plane or click to define the plane. So it needs to know where I want to draw. Do I want to draw on this grid? Or maybe onto one of the faces of my model. So this is really powerful. Unfortunately, it's not so powerful when it comes to snapping my lines to every point of my 3D model. But it's pretty nifty that you can change this grid. This is in fact what is called a work plane. So more or less a temporary grid, a temporary plane onto which you're drawing. So if in my case I'm choosing this side plane here, okay, I can specify the center of my circle and draw it, finish my sketch. The grid returns back to its default position, so you don't you can't alter this. Now what I can do to show you the power of the sketches. Now I can also do the same simple extrude, but this time I'll go inside my model, and what you'll see now is that it extrudes with this red color, which wasn't red before. This is because whenever you generate new geometry, you have four options for it. You can make it a join mesh, so a mesh that will add to another mesh, a cut mesh, which is what we have right now, an intersect, or a new solid. New solid is pretty much the same with join, just that it keeps the item separated. Now, 123D design automatically acknowledges when two shapes intersect. If they intersect in a manner similar to this, it knows that you most likely want to cut. So you see how this automatically changes. When we build this, it wasn't on cut, it was on join or new solid. Okay, so now we're on cut, and if I press enter, and I'll actually delete this sketch so we see better, I've just made a boolean transformation here. So I've subtracted the volume of my cylinder from the volume of this prism. Okay, so these are the basics of modeling and navigation in 123D design. One more thing that I want to show you, and it's pretty fundamental, is the view modes. So I already mentioned that you have here the navigation controls. We never use these buttons. It doesn't make sense. You just use the mouse buttons. But you also have the ability to preview geometry in different ways. Right now we're by default previewing in materials and outlines, but we can preview it in materials only, so getting rid of those outlines. We can also preview, and this is actually the most interesting view, in outlines only. So whenever we have a complex geometry, more complex than this one, you kind of need to really see and define the limits of your model. Moreover, you can switch to any side view or any particular view that is of important interest to you. And always you can right click here and choose orthographic view. So orthographic view is the type of view where perspective doesn't deform the geometry anymore. So the perspective rules don't apply, or they do apply, but the lines are always parallel one to another. So right now I can know very, very precisely where exactly is this circle in relation to the base. Is this segment too little or too large? I can measure that, and I can have a much, much clearer view of the model. So it's good to know that you have this flexibility of always switching between an open flow creation mode and a more rigid and precise. Not necessarily rigid, it's the same flexibility, but it's much more precise. So this is very, very cool about 123D design. Now, last and not least, if I delete this, you have this button right here, which expands into view modes. So in our case, I want to show solids. So show me all the solids that I've hidden, and also show me the sketches that I've hidden. Okay, so this is my iPhone 5 C cover. If you don't know the phone, I'm talking about this one. Well, not necessarily blue, but you get the picture. Now, what I wanted to do now is see how I can use some of the tools that I've talked about, and some of the other tools that 123D provides, to make this a bit more interesting. Now, this sketch here is only for reference, because one of the issues with 1-to-3D design is its snapping capabilities, but we'll get into that later. So right now the case is properly dimensioned, so the directions are properly set, all the radiuses are properly set. You can imagine the phone coming in just like this. Okay, so this will actually hold the case into place. All the thicknesses in here are 1.2 millimeters. I recommend going over 1 millimeter for basic plastic, so 1.2 is somewhere a safe bet. And I've just made this frame on top of these minimal corner pieces so that I can have this canvas to work on my design. Now this is a very very minimalistic cover right now. It pretty much covers the corners, but you can print it as is and it shouldn't influence any of the control buttons of the phone. Now everything is, I'm just covering just this radius pieces and going like this, so I'm not touching these buttons. The camera should be pretty safe, also the start button, also the ports from the bottom. Okay, great. So what we'll do now is build a primitive and let's try the code. Now I'll go a bit creative on this and just place it as is, and I'll worry about dimensioning later on. Now knowing that the 1.2 millimeter is my absolute minimum, that's a pretty important information for me, and I have it as a visual cue here, so I don't need to really worry that much about it right now. Okay, so I can pick this cone and click on it again to select its sub object. In this case I'm just selecting its surface, and I'll choose a shell. Now this will in fact trim the my cone. Okay, it's not the kind of shell behavior that we saw on the prism, and I want the thickness to be 1.2, because I press enter to confirm this. Now I want this to have the same height as the outer edges, because I'd like to multiply this trunked cone several times over and really get a nice pattern look, but I don't want it to be more extruded than this border piece. Okay, now if I want to make sure that this is 1.2, I can go to orthographic view, outlines only, and choose a side view. Now I can clearly notice how my object it fits perfectly into the 1.2 height of my frame. Okay, now I switch back to perspective, back to materials and outlines. Now this is definitely way too large, and I'll just, now I can select several pieces. I can select this face or this side face. Maybe press and pull. Yeah. Just a second. Now, apparently, I'll just escape that and try it one more time. Okay, now we're going. 1-to-3D has is still a pretty early software, so you'll notice some bugs. It's pretty slow when opening or saving your files. Also, I had some issues with deleting certain elements, but I'm having much confidence in the fact that the Autodesk will increasingly work on this software as they're becoming more and more popular, and the fact that they're free to use attracts a lot of users, and I'm sure many of them are interested in the commercial value of this software as well. So now, while I don't know exactly what is the exact diameter of my cone, I know for certain it's bigger than 1.2, and it's definitely printable. Okay, now I will place this so that it intersects my case. Actually, I'll try to intersect it less on the top side and more on this left side. Now, what I'll do is build a pattern with this. Now, I'll show you in a minute how we can do this. So it's pretty simple. Just select the mesh and go to pattern and choose rectangular pattern. So I click once and it tells me to select my solid. I've already selected it. I can select a different solid or a sub object, but right now I just want to select the direction of my pattern. So I can use any line in my design, because they're all or almost any line. For instance, this will work because I want to duplicate this on this direction. So this is a good direction. And right now I can visually drag my cone, and I want to make sure that it intersects my frame. Why? Because if it doesn't, then they'll just float in midair. So I can't have them floating around. I need to have them properly anchored at least on one direction. So I won't insist in anchoring them on this vertical direction, but I will on this horizontal one. And also, you can add to the quantity of this either by typing or by dragging this slider more to the left. Okay, now right now I need to decide how close do I want my items to be one to another. I want to make sure that they intersect sufficiently enough so that they won't break. So it seems that 11 is a bit too much and 10 is a bit too little for me. So actually, I'll just press escape to skip this transformation, and I'll do two things. First of all, I'll scale this back up, so I won't properly scale it, but increase its radius. Okay, so I don't want to increase its height. So you notice while I'm doing this, I'm not increasing its height. Now I'm just making it a bit larger. So I hope this will help me out. And press enter to confirm this. Now I can always measure this beforehand and just know for certain how many times I want to duplicate this, but I think it's pretty safe if do it pretty much by eye. And another operation that I want to do is actually rotate my mesh. Why? Because I want the cone to face downwards. So I want it to face the exterior. I don't want to see a bunch of intersected circles. I want to see these circles right here, which are rather smaller. Okay. So what I'll do is, once I've selected it, I choose move. So in fact, move brings up this gizmo, which also allows me to rotate my model. So what I need to do is select the proper axis of rotation. So in my case is this one. Now I can rotate it 180 degrees. Now I can easily type here 180 and just press enter. Okay. So this rotated my trunk cone, and now I can see it better from the bottom. So I need to keep in mind when I'm designing this that I should preview it from this side, okay? Because this is what I'll see. Great. So now I will work obviously from this end because it's a bit more natural since I'll print from the bottom up. Okay, so it's a bit and also the navigation is a bit unnatural when working like this. Okay. Now, again, I've selected my mesh. I'm going to pattern. I'm choosing rectangular pattern. I'm choosing the direction that interests me. I'm dragging this so as also this one intersects this piece. Maybe a bit closer, and I'm adding circles. So this time, yeah, 9 seems to be a great number. It seems to work fine with me. So this is the look I was talking about. This is quite an interesting look. And what I'll do now actually is also drag it on this side. So on the second direction, I just want to fill, I don't know, maybe just the top part. I don't want to fill it all. You can obviously do whatever you like. And let me just add to the quantity. Now, like I said, I only need this to intersect on one direction. So as long as these work as a unitary solid, I'm perfectly fine. I'm covered, so this will hold as a 3D print. So I'm pressing enter, and so I don't need them to also be rigid on this side. However, I made them just touch each other, so maybe they'll just get a bit of rigidity this way after printing them. So right now you can, I don't know, enhance this design in some way or another. Maybe you can go here and with control pressed you can select multiple items and also deselect them. So let me do that again. So I'm pressing control. So I've selected these and now I'm pressing delete key. So this made I don't know, an eye shape. You can make some typing. Just make sure that you don't completely isolate or isolate an element so to the degree where it's not stable anymore. So for instance, if I delete this piece right here, this one will only be linked insufficiently to this one from the top. So I'll undo that. So please make sure if you do this type of design that you have the minimum rigidity in your design, so you don't have especially you mustn't have floating parts. So right now I think this looks pretty interesting. This reminds us of the official of C version of the iPhone cases, right, with the circles. Okay, so what I'll do now is just finish my design with actually I'll go for a spline. Now I have to pick up my sketch plane, so I will select this sketch. I will tell it that I want to edit this one, so this will allow me to go. You see how the X marks the fact that it snaps onto something, so I'm going precisely from the grid side. So this is a curved line. Oh, I can go until I'm happy, then I press enter. And you can obviously modify it. So I'm actually I'm just trying to find something interesting. Maybe break the symmetry a bit. I don't know exactly what this is, so I leave it as such. So how do you go from one line to something that is solid? Well, that's pretty easy. Just you can select or not your design. Let me just select it, and from the sketch panel we choose offset. So this will make we reselect our line. This will make an offset of our design. So I can go inwards or outwards. So notice when I go outwards, I can only go by some amount, because probably one of these radiuses becomes too little, so I can't go too far. Just click once, okay, and press enter to finish this operation. Now, a problem with offsetting this type of shapes is that more often than not they won't be editable. So if before I could edit this, and I can still edit them, now I can't edit these ones. You see, if I try to edit them, they turn into a line. So what I need to do now is make sure they extend up to this edge right here. So I'll just add a short polyline to them, and I see that it alters my design. Maybe go like this. So I'm not trying to continue it, as 123D will make this tangent point and consider it something else. And right now you see how you can somehow define some shapes right here, but you notice how I cannot define my shape. This is because this segment is interpreted as one long segment. So to fix this, we'll go to sketch. So all our main tools for sketching are here, and we choose trim. So trim is used to clean the design. So I will just trim this line and this line, and also the ones from above. So I've cleared most of my lines from my design. I don't need them anymore. I can also delete the bottom ones. So this trim tool actually doubles as a delete tool as well. So it's not only trimming a line between two other lines. So I'm finishing this operation. I noticed that in here I've got this edge left. Now if I somehow find this too cluttered to understand, I can hover my mouse over this button and choose hide solids. And after a while, you see it selected all the solids, and it left me with only with my drawings. So I see I have this nice drawing right here. I have this edge that is a bit off. So what I'll do, I'll go to trim again and just select my sketch first, and then select this. You see how trim finds intersecting lines and gives you the option to delete one of them. So finish this, and then I'll add another polyline to this sketch from this point to this point. So now, whenever a sketch is a closed sketch, 123D will make it filled. Okay, so it will make it we could say a surface. So from simple lines, closed simple lines turned into surfaces. Now we can show our solids again. We'll wait a bit for this, okay. And now all we have to do is extrude this shape up. So obviously we'll extrude it by 1.2 millimeters. I've pressed enter. And I can hide my sketches to see my result. And this looks pretty good. If you're worried about this, for instance, right here, for some reason or another, when I've connected my points, it didn't kept the its original trace. Now I can always select this edge and choose to tweak it. So I'll just go extra on it. So I'm not afraid to intersect shapes in 123D design. I can press enter. Now if I want to fix this, even though it's not mandatory, but if I want to have them not intersecting like this, now first of all I select this frame, and when I've built it I made it a group. So you notice this toggle here, which allows me to ungroup them. So actually I'll ungroup them from this button right here. Makes more sense for me. Okay, so now my frame is different meshes, and I can select one of my solids and go to the combine tab, click once and select one solid and then another. And right here make sure it's join, so it's not subtract or intersect. So I want to combine my meshes by joining them. So I press enter, and you notice how since they were of the same height, they turned into one smooth mesh, where this face is just one continuous face. Okay, so this is my design. I'll tell you from the start, if you have a logo or some other complex shapes in mind, 123D at this point doesn't allow the import of external files, so you can only import other 123D design files. But you can also always work a bit, maybe simplify your complex design and draw it from scratch inside 123D design, especially if you know your dimensions or the dimensions for your design. Okay, so to wrap this up, I will just use the subtract tool one more time. So you notice how the camera is located in here, and in theory at least our model, if you notice, this radius right here is the corner radius where the camera comes. So the camera is more or less around this spot right here. You notice where the radius comes. But if you want to just make sure that the camera has plenty of space, we can always draw a circle, and we choose first as a sketch plane the grid, and I'll draw one in here. Okay, sorry. So I'll draw one. I've pressed the escape key to stop drawing circles, because I want to draw them one by one. Now after drawing this, just select it, choose extrude, drag him upwards. You'll notice that this is now again a red geometry, and you instantly notice how it cuts. This is because it's preset to cut. So just press enter, and then actually I'll use the same circle and just go a bit downwards in here. I don't want to go too much, so it still has some meat in here, and go again to extrude and just raise it just enough so it fully intersects the model. You don't want to, if I, sorry for this camera angle, but if I raise it just a little, it will only subtract like a portion of my mesh. So I just want to make sure that you can go overboard with this. Make sure you don't intersect other models. But that's pretty much it. Just press enter again. So now I can delete this. I don't need it. So now I just made sure that the camera has also not only space for the objective, but also that I'm not casting shadows really near to the objective. So when designing a case, actually when prototyping a case, it's important to keep in mind that prototyping is a work in progress. So I might print this and see that these are pretty fragile, or maybe the design isn't so interesting. I don't know. So I'll just go back and print it again and again until I find myself satisfied with my design. Okay, so take it as a work in progress. Make sure that you understand the dimensions of your mesh first, and then go ahead and prototype. Thank you very much for following this 1-2-3D design tutorial. I'll be building more of these on the 3D printing topic. So please make sure you check out Digital Art Scoop website regularly for new tutorials.